enthusiasm, especially there are few of you who have like interacted with the panelists, you have spoken your heart out, and this is the kind of session that we look for. It has been very interactive as well. There's one particular topic which is currently of great importance for SMEs, which is the goods and the services tax. The GST has come and it has been over 2 months now. There are still some confusions and some good effect of the GST implementation. So this session we are having Sri Abhay Desai here, who will address our queries as representing you as an audience. I'll raise three queries with Mr. Desai, and once I'm through with once Mr. Desai is through with addressing those queries, then we'll let the floor open for your interaction with Mr. Desai. So welcome, Mr. Desai.
Thank you, it's my pleasure. Yeah, and I'm actually coming in between you and lunch because by 1:15 I think both of things should have started. But it's a very interesting topic. I think one of the key theme of today's session is itself that digitizing in the GST era.
Yes, exactly.
So it's a very relevant topic.
Right. So to start with, we would request you to first give a introduction or a brief on GST and its positive impacts that it has created.
See, ideally we are, I'm using the word ideally because we are far from ideal as far as the real GST is concerned. But we always say that the entrepreneurs who are working in our country deserves Padma Shri, because the kind of harassment that they go through from the various departmental officers is really tough to see. And as far as GST is concerned, as you are all aware, that before GST we had multiple taxes, state level, central level. At the central level, we had central excise and service tax, the key indirect taxes. Excise was levied on manufacture, service tax was levied on provision of service. At the state level, we had VAT, which was a tax levied on sale of goods. What used to happen, that each state had their own different VAT, so a person looking into setting up businesses across multiple states had to go through multiple laws, different procedural aspects, different compliance mechanisms, different officers to deal with. Tax point was also different, excise was on manufacture, VAT is on sale, goods were covered under VAT, services were covered under central law, so there has been huge confusion, especially in sectors like IT, real estate, where there is now a thin line between goods and service. Now day by day, goods and services, basically there is no difference. And there was a lot of multiple taxes. If you see, even companies like Microsoft, they were charging VAT as well as service tax. When you buy a license from them, so they were fed up. Even Supreme Court had said that say goods and services are different, but still the companies were so fed up with the departmental harassment.
Very long discussion just 6 months back on this issue.
Okay, so the Telkar committee was set up when Atal Bihari Vajpayee was our Prime Minister to look into this issue. So he suggested that now the time is ripe to go into a GST era. But at that time, if you recollect, sales tax was in place. Now sales tax was single point tax, it was not a multiple point tax where the tax was paid by the entire value chain. So that is why he suggested better first we should go for VAT, let all the state governments come on VAT model. Earlier ModVAT scheme was there, which was converted in 2004 to ZenVAT, where now you will also be able to cross avail service credit against the goods and vice versa. And eventually, it has been a long time, actually government should be complimented, because we, the politicians in our country, are very greedy. And the states wanted, did not want the revenue to go away or control over the revenue to go away. So it has been a momentous task. Our current Prime Minister, when he was the Chief Minister, he opposed. When he went, he said that now I got a better picture of the scenario, and now he supports. So it has seen a lot of political battles also. Even West Bengal, one of the key states who opposed, and probably one was the last state to come on board. So it has come. The benefits of GST is now goods and services both will be taxed under a single piece of legislation. We don't have multiple legislations to deal with. If your product is classified as goods, there is no need to worry that it will be again classified as a service at some point in future and you will end up again paying tax. Indirect tax is very important. Why? Because this is the tax which you have to collect from your customer and pay. It is not like a direct tax. Today in direct tax, if I make some mistake, it is out of my profit that I am paying. So if I have claimed more expense, no problem, I can pay the direct tax at a later date with interest or consequential penalties. But in indirect tax, if you pay 18% and tomorrow if the government thinks it should have been 28, the 10% you have to pay from your pocket along with interest and penalty. So it will eventually wipe out your entire margin. So that is why indirect tax is much more crucial than the direct tax, because this is something that you have to collect. The key benefit is credit will be allowed across the board. Earlier, you are all aware that central sales tax that you used to pay when you purchase goods from outside Gujarat, credit was not available of CST, now credit will be available. A trader was not allowed credit of the tax on services that he used to pay, so that was also a big revenue blockage. Only credit up to the manufacturing stage was allowed. Post-manufacturing stage, under the central excise law, credit was not allowed. So the rent or something that you pay for the godown, credit was not allowed. Even transportation, the service tax on transportation, post the removal from your factory, the credit was not allowed. So a lot of things were becoming a cost. For an exporter also, it was detrimental, because the CST that you pay on the raw material which you are going to use for export, you didn't get the refund of that CST. That was eventually becoming part of the cost. Even though the constitution clearly says that you can export goods or services, you cannot export taxes. But because of the earlier structure, we were also exporting indirectly taxes outside the country because they were part of our cost. So all those things, GST has really will be helping export sector more particularly. And I think because of the way the credit will be available, your overall cost should probably in the long term should go down, the rates should rationalize as we move ahead, because government, see, in India it's a black box economy, no one really knows what will be the revenue for the government. So that is why they have started with a baseline rate. As we go ahead, as the revenue figures come in, they will do the tinkering with the rates, and eventually it should rationalize, because the tax base is going to expand drastically. Even our Prime Minister recently said that this 20 lakh limit also it should be removed. People should register under GST from day one, from the day on which they start doing business. Up to 20 lakhs, there should be a simpler scheme where you pay X percentage on that turnover. You don't avail the credit, but at least you will come under the tax net. They will be able to do the data mining, cross-relate your data with your income tax data, because we have seen a lot of clients who have been bold enough to show different figures in their VAT return and different figures in their income tax return, because there was no cross verification between those two sets of returns. So gradually that will be the biggest game changer for the economy. That lot of data mining will be available, algorithms will be put in place. So next time when a notice will come, it will be a pinpointed notice that this is what your GST return says, this is what your IT return says, this is the mismatch. You kindly come and explain only this point to us. Where is the difference? The notices will not come in a general way that you bring all your books of accounts and we will see all the books of accounts and then we'll raise the queries. Queries will be raised by the system itself. So to that extent, it will bring a greater transparency in our economy. And last point, in our country, invoice is also goods. People buy and sell invoices. So when you have a higher profit, you want to lower your profit, you want to save income tax, you buy an invoice, and people have been bold enough also to claim the credit on that invoice, which they themselves were making. And since there was no cross-check mechanism available, it was very difficult for the department to unearth this kind of cases. Now in GST, credit will be available just like the way you get credit of TDS under income tax, only if online it is going to match. And if your supplier is going to pay the tax, then only you will get the credit. So that bogus invoice racket also to a large extent will be cured because of GST.
Thank you so much. The next query that, or the next point that the audience would like to understand is the challenges in implementing GST from an SME perspective.
So this is really an area where the government has miserably failed, because I have to be open, and I also don't care if the government officer is sitting here, because even in the department with the finance minister, when we meet, because I'm part of the GST Council advising the government on the GST framework, we openly tell that the intent was good, but where you have failed is in systems. The implementation has been miserable. What is from the legal part, we'll discuss first and then we go on the accounting part. From the legal front, you will find that in the month of July, the government itself came out with lot of press releases, lot of Twitter replies. And lot of those replies have been confusing. Even in Twitter, if you find that one reply 2 hours back would be different from the reply given after 2 hours on identical question. So that created more confusion. In fact, customs also, if you, those who have read the custom communication on 1st of July, they said that whatever goods that you have imported before 1st of July, you have to pay custom duty and the CVD SAD, the earlier tax. Actually, as per law, you are supposed to pay now IGST because the duty at the time of removal has to be seen,
yes,
not the duty at the time.
On the day of clearance.
Correct. So, a lot of that created more confusion. There was no integration between the departments and Twitter became one of the great media to resolve the queries. And Twitter, the reply came first and then there was notification which was being issued. In fact, our revenue secretary, Mr. Radia, he also really does not really understand what GST is. So on in his master class, which he did in first week of July, he gave some opinions and then the government came out with a press release saying that upon further examination, we found that that opinion was not correct and this is the correct opinion. So even if you can understand a person of revenue secretary stage, if he can goof up while interpreting the provision, what will happen to the layman? So on the legal front, that is where they have really messed up. In fact, we had given an option also to them that whatever queries that you are getting, you create a panel of consultants, you select 10-15 good consultants across India, let them answer the queries, don't ask the government department to answer the queries because the law has changed but their mindset has not changed. Unfortunately, that is the biggest problem in our country. That laws are changing but the mindset today, if you go to the department, if you want to get LUT or bond, if you are an exporter, the same old mindset continues, the same old requirement of some gratification, some same old requirement of paperwork which is not needed under the GST regime, still that mindset has not changed. So on the legal front, government should have been more open, more communicative, it should have centralized the communication and should have bring in a better learned people to really throw light, and that too in a layman's language and not using a technical jargon. If you see the leaflets that they are coming out every second day, those leaflets also, they are pure legal jargon which a person like me or probably a one who is practicing in this area can really understand. For a lay person, it is very difficult to really
understand.
You are
practicing, CA or a practicing person,
yes,
is also not understanding in a clear way.
On the second front, on the systems front, government should have really streamlined, should have given free software. That was our request from day one, that SMEs cannot afford the high price softwares. If you see earlier, especially the big accounting firms, they tried to create an image as if that if you don't have an ASP or a GSP, you will not be able to file the returns, you are very late in your GST implementation effort, you should have selected, they charge lakhs of rupees for ASP, GSP. But if you really understand the ASP, GSP, it's not rocket science. It is our VLOOKUP that we do in our Excel sheet. Data matching is nothing but a simple exercise where you compare two sets of data, find out the invoices which are not reflected and you take the corrective actions. It's a simpler work, but the way it was made out. Second, the APIs were released very late. In fact, government has not yet released API for GSTR2. Since API was not released late, even software companies were helpless. They were also not ready with their product well before the GST return filing started. So people were helpless. They didn't have any clue how to go about filing the return. The government kept on extending the dates. July return, initially as per law, the date was 20th August. They increased to 25th, then again 28th. Then again now it has happened that it has gone to October. So in October we will be filing July returns. So probably November, December returns would be filed next year, June, July. So that is how it seems. But that is again shows the total unpreparedness. They had to remove the chairman of GSTN, the person who designed this system, and that too this late. If he has been inefficient. The government should have taken this decision well in advance. So on systems front, they have failed. Second, SMEs, from SME perspective, even SMEs took it very lightly initially. Yes. They thought that GST would never come in our country. Yes. So people didn't believe when the government stood firm on 1st of July deadline. They still thought that it is not going to happen. Someone in the media also, you will find it very amusing that you kept on hearing so many days that now since Diwali is approaching, government will not bring GST now, they will don't disturb, they will not disturb Diwali. And someone used to say that they are changing the calendar year. So probably GST they will come from 1st of January. So there was a lot of myth, but government stood firm. So SMEs were also caught off guard. Large companies appointed consultants, they did the internal study, they assessed what will be the impact on the pricing of their product, what will be the impact on their cost. But SME sector was caught totally off guard. So then they had to really make more efforts to do the correct pricing. In fact, a lot of you must also have received letters from your big vendor saying that if there is an anti-profitery involved, then you pass the benefit to us. A lot of companies which are here would have received this kind of letter. So when SME came to us, we had to first explain what anti-profiteering is. And then we had to explain that this is the benefit which law says that you have to pass to your customer, and that is why this your client is asking you to lower your price, because this is the reduction in your cost on account of change in the taxation structure. The law says you have to pass it to the consumer. So that also preparedness was not there, but now slowly, as it happens always, we are adjusting to the scenario. It is like we always say GST and India is an arranged marriage, not a love marriage. So wife is also arranging slowly, steadily. The wife is also learning about the new home. At the same time, husband is also trying to change his behavior towards the whole family and try to accommodate the wife which has entered the house. So that process will continue for some time in future. But we hope that eventually the marriage succeeds, because that is the only option now we have. And it has to succeed, but only time will tell how much cost it will result in. See, eventually it is going to succeed, not 1 year down the line, not 2 years down the line, but the GDP loss that we will have to incur, that will be a big cost to us. So that is why we have requested time and again that now when they are coming with the revised GSTN, it better be foolproof, so that again they don't have to extend the dates and again go through this entire process.
Thank you so much. That was also very enriching. And before I open the floor for question and answer, the third query that I would ask you to address is, what precaution is required by SMEs in implementation of GST at their end?
See, the biggest precaution that is required in GST is to carefully pick your suppliers. That is the biggest precaution that you will have to take, because till now you have not faced the real GST. The real GST you will face 1 year, 1 month down the line when you get this beautiful form GSTR 2A. See, what the government has done, they said that everyone in our country will now play casino. Casino is illegal except Goa and Sikkim. But now, because of GST, you will all be playing casino. Now I'll explain how you will all be playing casino. On 10th, you have to file your outward supply return, capturing your sales of the previous month. On the 15th, that data will be auto-populated and your customer will be able to view that data on 11th. That these are the sales that you have made to him. On 15th, he has to play a casino. How? Because he has to decide whether to claim the credit or not. If he claims the credit on 15th, which obviously everyone will, and let us say if you fail to pay before 20th, then that credit will be reversed subsequently with interest for that 1 month. And that re-credit will take place only if the customer pays. So this condition that the vendor has to pay, and that condition you will come to know only post availment of credit. Before availment of credit, obviously you will not come to know. So that is the biggest check that you will have to do, because in India we know how our vendors are, how our suppliers are. So trusting your supplier will not just work, although employer-employee, as the session said, trust is something that you, it's a partner, but here in, when it comes to law, we forget about partnership. We insist on clauses in the purchase order, where one of the clauses that you will insert in your purchase order that will release, if for the suppliers who you feel may not be that law compliant, that will release the tax payment once it is confirmed online. We will not release you the tax payment till we get the confirmation online, because if you don't do that, even that money of tax, and he does not pay, eventually you will end up not only losing that money, but also you will end up paying interest on that credit that you are wrongly availed. Second important step that is required is that there will be a GST compliance rating score, which the government is going to do. So how you will be rated on the basis of your compliance, on the basis of the timely payment of tax. It is very crucial for SME sector, because all your customers will be looking at the GST rating score, which will be available in the public domain, to judge your brand value and to judge your professionalism. So that is why not just it will impact your interaction with the department, because a low rating score will obviously attract departmental attention, so you will be visited with far more audits, but it will have an impact directly on your business. In the past, if you had defaulted in excise, VAT, service tax, your customer would never know. Customer would think that you are always law compliant, because you have issued the invoice, so you must be paying the taxes. Now in GST regime, the moment you falter, your rating will go down. The moment your rating goes down, in fact, we have come across a lot of purchase orders also, where one of the conditions that is put by large companies is that if your rating goes beyond a certain level, which they will fix when the ratings are available online, will not deal with you and will simply struck off business relations with you. So despite your good quality of product, despite everything is fine, so rating goes down, it will directly hit you. Even banks are going to now look at the GST rating score, and not just the CRISIL score, before judging whether to...
CRISIL will see na, that rating.
Correct.
Before granting either ratings.
Correct. And the last important thing that you have to take care of is that you need a good accountant. Accountant will be the most important person in your office for the next at least couple of years till the GST is settled, and enough accountants are available in the market to replace him if he wants to leave. Because in India we have a huge shortage of good accountants. We have an accountants who generally use shortcuts, especially what we have seen in the SME sector. They don't do thorough accounting. If a travelling voucher is there, if the person, if the employee has incurred, let us say, 8,000 rupees, he has gone on a 5-day tour, nobody would care to account that 8,000 rupees by giving a detailed breakup of how much was towards hotel, how much was towards conveyance, how much is towards food and beverage. In GST, that will cost you. Because in GST, we have this condition that if you have availed any goods or services from unregistered suppliers, and if the aggregate value exceeds 5,000 rupees in a day, you have to pay tax under reverse charge. Now that you will come to know only if that proper accounting is done in the system, which can pull out this data, that these are the expenses on which I am required to pay reverse charge. And if you don't pay reverse charge during the departmental audit, if they find out, you will end up paying interest and penalty also on those, on this tax for the fault of your account. Second, 10th, 15th and 20th, most crucial dates. No extension allowed. If you fail to file the return on 10th, it will not be taken for processing. All your customers are going to lose the credit for that 1 month. The system will open for filing the outward supply return only after 20th. So you will have to ensure that your accountant's health is absolutely fit and fine on 10th, 15th and 20th. And remember, there is no concept of Sunday in e-filing. On if the 10th comes, happens to be Sunday, still the due date will remain 10th. So that also...
No, 1 day prior or 1 day after.
In earlier manual filing, we had the law where it says that if it's a public holiday, the due date will be automatically extended to the next working day. In GST e-filing regime, we don't have those kind of extension. So that is why it is very important that you select a good accountant. If you have to incur 1,000 rupees, incur and send him for a good training, because he, see, as a consultant also, we will come to know of the problem only if those problems are brought before us. It's like a doctor. If you don't come and share what is really happening to you, we cannot imagine sitting in our office that what you are doing at your factory. So that is why unless an accountant is vigilant, if what is the least requirement of him, that he, whenever he sees something out of sync or something which is not normal, he must, that light bulb must ring in his mind, and he must contact any person within your organization or an outside consultant who can throw some light on the tax treatment on that transaction. So at least that minimum an accountant must be educated. He cannot just merely go on doing the accounting work in FSR way in which he has been doing up till now. And now monthly filing, the data is part of the system. So the moment you file even wrong return, it is captured by the system. So you can rectify it, but then the department will ask you 10 questions that why your earlier turnover in the return was 5 crores, now you have reduced it to 4 crores. You explain what is, now you cannot say that accountant by mistake has had punched the invoices twice. It will be very unnecessary, your management time will be wasted. Rather than devoting your time on the real issues of growing your business, you will end up devoting your time with the useless officers where, despite any arguments, if they have made up the mind to harass you, they will eventually harass you.
There have been very, very pertinent piece of advices by Mr. Desai. So even in the interest of time, and since we are standing between you and your lunch, we would quickly take one or two questions, and we'll proceed to the next session.
See, as far as the credit is concerned, now also the 2A data is, once the returns are filed, of course many have started, though the date is still 10th, you can start seeing now itself, because the data is available. If someone has already filed, then data is available. And as far as the credit is concerned, actually, credit taking in your accounts is your, and payment is you have to make. See, the supplier who has supplied you, you have taken credit. Now it is your duty to make the payment to the supplier, and that is captured, going to come in the return. When maybe after 6 months, that is the current time limit which has been given. But once you take the credit, knowingly that yes, this is the right credit, then so what you advise, that no, by the time of taking credit itself, you have to assure that yes, you are taking the right credit. And in any case, the system is allowing you to postpone the taking credit for perhaps 6 months or so.
I agree, system is allowing you, you can take the credit even later on, up to next September. But here we are talking about cash flow impact. Yes. If you don't take the credit today, 18%, 28% is a huge amount that will get stuck. So that is not an option that we can
In any case, working capital has already been stuck with this regime.
And the second aspect that what he referred to, there is a good provision in the GST law which says that if I have availed the credit on your invoice, if I have not paid you the basic amount plus the GST amount, I will have to reverse the credit at the end of 6 months along with interest for the 6 months, and I will be able to get the re-credit when I make the payment. Now this provision has been criticized by a lot of experts, saying that this is not required in law, because if I have paid GST to you, you have raised an invoice on me, we are on accrual system of accounting, so it was your duty to pay the GST in time. What, how, when I pay to you is not material. But in my personal view, it's a very beneficial provision, more particularly for the SME sector, because this will ensure that at least within 6 months you will get the payment, because then the customer will also have a cost to incur if he does not pay you within 6 months. So it's a beneficial provision applicable for goods as well as services.
For a long term, it is a really a good provision. It needs that change of mindset of the entrepreneurs also. Not only the accountant, but the mindset of the entrepreneur has to change with this regime.
See, on this point, actually, when we met Arun Jaitley, we explained to him that why in India we have so complex legal system, because we have so many developed countries, already material is available with us, we just copy paste their system, tune it to our requirement, and that would be the best solution. But the problem he said, and rightly he pointed out, that problem is not just with the government. The problem is with the entrepreneurs. They are trying to find loopholes in the law, trying to take advantage of those loopholes. So we try to curb that or plug that loophole. They invent one more loophole. We try to plug that also. And at the end of the day, the law becomes so complex that if you want to really understand a simple provision, you have to refer to 10 notifications, 5 circulars, and then you will get the real idea of what that particular small section wants to say. So that attitude of finding profits from taxation is wrong. You should better generate. If your business is not generating profit, trying to generate by playing with the tax policy will eventually not work for long term. It will eventually end up in your closure of business. So try to be law compliant as far as possible. It's an indirect tax, as I again say. It is not that you have to pay from your pocket, you have to collect it. Your customer is also going to get the credit if it is B2B. So why unnecessarily to take the risk on your head when the credit will be available to your customer?
Sir, RCM limit is 5,000 per day is applicable for only unregistered purchases?
Obviously, unregistered only. Unregistered.
Only
unregistered. Registered anyway is going to charge GST in the US. Oh, in a day, your expense from unregistered suppliers, if it is going to exceed 5,000, on that particular day, you have to pay at the reverse charge on the total value, not on the excess part.
So in that case, how can we know that he has gone for this consolidation scheme or not?
Who? Unregistered means on the unregistered supplier means he will be issuing a invoice without GST number.
Exactly.
If he is issuing invoice with GST number, it means he is registered.
Accepted, whether
he is charging or not.
That is, once he is registered, you don't have to worry.
Unregistered is the date of invoice or the date you make the payment?
Date on which you receive the goods or services, that will be date of invoice.
Not the day when you make the payment.
And this 5,000 rupees is aggregate per supplier. Suppose I make 7 transactions of 1,000 rupees each. From unregistered dealers, then would we still qualify for RCM?
5,000 is aggregate, all suppliers put together.
Yeah.
All unregistered suppliers, not per supplier.
Actually, I mean, per supplier, but 5,000
it
is not
like that.
No.
You will have 100 suppliers. You will sit with that baby names dictionary. And every morning you will see that, okay, today, about which supplier to create. It is aggregate. And you have to pay also, again I am repeating, if 7,000 is the expense, you have to pay on entire 7,000, not on 2,000.
Sir, about HSN code, specifically in my engineering business area, hardly 10% of the HSN code defined to the product. Now one conflict has started, that customer saying, you are charging 18%, that X, other than Y supplier is charging 12%, why should we have 18%? I said, this is the HSN code, it is mentioned in the book. They say, okay, but why it is mentioned? Because the name of the instrument is exactly not mentioned on the HSN code detail. So there is a conflict between this. Now, how should I move?
You should contact us. See, in a lighter way. But this is an issue about classification.
Yes.
So unless we go into the facts, it will be very difficult for me to comment that whether 12 is correct or 18 is correct.
Yes.
A small example I will share with you. Fire extinguisher is taxed at 28% and sprayer are taxed at 18%. So one client came to us last week saying that what I am selling is a fire extinguishing system which contains a sprayer which is for industrial use. So whether it has to be called a fire extinguisher or a sprayer. If I call it as a fire extinguisher, see what we understand fire extinguisher, something that we have in our homes, the cylinder with a red color mark on it. That is how we generally understand fire extinguisher. But when we looked into the dictionary, into the judgments, we found that fire extinguisher means any device which extinguishes fire. So it can, the size does not matter. So these kind of classification issues are there. So you will have to really go into the detail. And your brand name you will not find in the HSN because HSN is based on the technical.
Say for example, one product is Borescope is, second name is pipe inspection camera. If I go to the list, pipe inspection camera, they will capture the camera 28%. If I go to the Borescope with the medical head, there's a different person. Now, till today I sell this product as a pipe inspection camera, now I should start as a selling as a Bosco. Then customer said, मैंने तो pipe inspection camera मांगा था, मतलब कितना GST देना है? क्योंकि list पे there are two things. So there are lot of conflict.
No, there are lot of.
Right.
Yeah. Every day we get at least 15 queries on classification.
And number of queries.
See what has happened. Actually, ideally GST should have been a single rate GST, the way we have in developed countries. All products, all services, single rate, no classification disputes. But in India, the reality is that we have to keep multiple rates because we have to differentiate between rich and the poor. So things like which poor people are buying, we cannot tax it at a revenue neutral rate was 70%, which the Subramanian committee recommended. But that rate we could not tax all the products. For example, food grains, we cannot tax it at 17%. Milk, we cannot tax it at 17%. So we had to create multiple rates. But eventually, as even the Arun Jaitley has said, that as the country develops, eventually the next big change would be rationalization in rates, where from 4 we may go to 3 first, from 3 to 2, and then eventually to a single rate taxation system. But till that time, classification disputes are there. In fact, it has increased in GST regime because in excise we had 2 rates only. Now we have to deal with 5 rates because 0 is also 1 rate.
Yes.
So, we have to deal with 5 rates plus compensation cess. And there also we have different products carrying different rates. So this is something where for all your knowledge, there is a mechanism for advance ruling under the GST regime. So if you are having some doubts about the classification, then you can approach the advance ruling authority. It's a government authority. You make an application, you represent your case, you give your classification, they may agree or they may classify it in some other category, and that is how you will get the certainty.
So whom he should approach directly?
You concentrate on the manufacturing.
Recently, a case has been filed by the local tax association in Rajasthan High Court as well as in some other high courts also against the hurriedly implementation of GST. So, if the court admits, I think it has been admitted, it's in favor of the tax association. What are your views? What will happen?
These kind of cases you will come across for next 2-3 years at least.
Yes.
Now taxation is within the legislative competence of the government. So even if let us say the courts ruled, I don't think they will rule against, but even if they rule against the government, they will come out with a retrospective amendment. It is not as if India will become GST free and government will allow that situation. So eventually it will even let us say, for example, the Delhi High Court recently ruled that advance license, if you are having, you can use that for payment against IGST on import. The law does not permit.
Yes.
But interim judgment has been given by the Delhi High Court. Now what has happened in the media, in WhatsApp, only these two lines are being circulated. Now you can use advance license against import.
But
if you really see the judgment,
no custom officer is permitting that.
No sir, forget about practice. I will explain. If you read the judgment, judgment says that in the facts in that case were that the export orders were placed before 1st of July.
Yes.
And the SSC argued that when the export order was placed on me, I did not contemplate IGST on import as additional cost because ultimately my working capital will get blown. So when I quoted for the export order, I did not consider this part as my cost. So the court said that this is a legal argument and a valid argument. And that is why we are permitting you to import raw material against the advance license. So first, it is case-specific judgment, not a general guideline, that if you receive the export order today, you cannot argue that on basis of Delhi High Court ruling, I will not pay IGST. Second, in that judgment, in the end, they will say that this is an interim order. If we eventually hold that IGST was payable, you will have to pay with interest and penalty. So exactly these words are mentioned in the order. So that is why you cannot just blindly rely on this kind of news. You will have to really go into the judgment and then see if the same can be applied in your case. But for your query, see all this, if you have seen Jolly LLB, the lawyers are fond of lawyers are fond of filing these kind of petitions because that is how they get free publicity. without incurring a single rupee of marketing cost. So lawyers are, I'm also a lawyer by the way, but they are smart. So a lot of futile cases are getting filed, but you focus on your business, you don't have to worry about all these constitutional matters. And eventually, if at all if it is held invalid, the government is going to validate it through a retrospective amendment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Desai. Actually, it was a very enriching session overall.